Anybody glad to be in the house on a Palm Sunday? Hallelujah. So we're going to go before the Lord in prayer this morning. Great and holy God, we come to you on today, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the creator of night and day, of evening and morning. We come to you this morning, Father, thankful that you blessed us all with life, health, and strength once again, Lord. We thank you, Father, that you kept us as we laid in our beds last night. You called our names one more time on today, Lord. You allowed us to open our eyes on today. You allowed us, Father, to get up and to walk, Lord. You allowed us all to make it here safely. Thank you, Father. Father, we ask right now that you would watch over those who are preparing to come, Father. We pray for safe travels. We pray, Father, that all minds and hearts are on you on today, Father. We love you so much. We ask, Father, right now that you would just clear our minds so we can hear from heaven on today, Lord. That's what we want, God. We want to hear from heaven on today, Lord. So speak to us. You are worthy, worthy, worthy. So, saints, today I want us to just focus on trusting in the Lord. Let's reflect back on the week that just passed and think about how good our Lord was to us. He is our comfort, our redeemer, the lover of our souls. And we thank you, Lord. I want to read Isaiah 40, 31. And it reads, "But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." So let us go before the Lord, because our week wasn't perfect, but the Lord allowed us to run. He allowed us to continue to walk when we couldn't run, and we made it through. So for the next 60 seconds, let's just think about how the Lord brought us through last week and prepare our minds and our hearts to give him praise for it. Heavenly Father, we thank you. There were so many attacks of the enemy coming our way, but God, you're our comforter, Lord. When others don't see what's going on, you are our comforter, Lord. You're our strength. Not just physically, Lord, but spiritually. And we thank you, Lord. So, Lord, as we wait, we are trusting in your miraculous power, Lord, to move, Father, in our homes, in our churches, Lord. in our communities, in our marriages, in our single lives, in our parenting. Father, we are trusting in you for those things that are unseen, for healing in our bodies, Lord. We're trusting in you, O Lord. We need you, Father. Touch us, Lord. Heal us, Lord. We need you, Father. Father, we know that your mercies are new every morning. May we not take them for granted, Lord. Every morning your mercies are new. Let us not overlook them, Lord. Father, you know our prayers even before we pray, Lord. You know our burdens. You know our needs. But we need you, Lord. This world needs you, Lord. And we hear your vessels, God, want to take your word out, God, to the world. But as we do, Father, we know that the enemy does not want it. As we march on the black gates, Father, we need you, Father. Lord, we need you. We cannot do it on our own, Lord. Jesus, you are our strong foundation. And we need you. Comfort us, O Lord. Here in our land, Father, heal our land, O Lord. Use us, Lord. Use us to call those to you, God, and which you put in our path. Give us the courage, God, to speak your word. Give us the boldness, Father, to speak your word. Remove all fear, O Lord. Allow your Holy Spirit to comfort us, because we need it, Father. Saints, I want to read to you a prayer from the Valley of Vision. We all go through life, good, bad, ups and down. But this prayer is called Comforts. And if any of this resonate with you, let's prepare to give the Lord some praise today. And it reads, Giver of all good, streams upon streams of love overflow my path. Thou hast made me out of nothing, hast recalled me from a far country, hast translated me from ignorance to knowledge, from darkness to light, from death to life, from misery to peace, from folly to wisdom, from error to truth, from sin to victory. Thanks be to thee for my high and holy calling. I bless thee for ministering angels, for the comfort of thy word, for the ordinances of thy church, for the teaching of thy Spirit, for thy holy sacraments, for the communion of saints, for Christian fellowship, for the recorded annals of holy lives, for examples sweet to allure, for beacons sad to deter. Thy will is in all thy provisions to enable me to grow in grace and to be meet for thy eternal presence. My heaven-born faith gives promise of eternal sight, my new birth a pledge of never-ending life. I draw near to thee, knowing thou wilt draw near to me. I ask thee, believing thou hast already given. I entrust myself to thee, for thou hast redeemed me. I bless and adore thee, the eternal God, for the comfort of these thoughts, for the joy of these hopes. If you are able and willing, I would ask that you stand. Let's give our God some praise and worship in here. Yes, you are, Lord. Father, you are so worthy of our praise, O Lord. We come lifting our voices to you on today, Lord. Receive our praise on today, O God. Receive our songs of worship as we lift up your name. Receive our praises as we give you glory, as we bow before you on today, O Lord. We love you, O Lord. You are great, and there is none like you. None. So, Father, as we go forward today, God, have your way. Holy Spirit, just sit with us on today. We need you, O Lord. We need you, O Lord. Be with us on today, God. Cover this place on today, O Lord. Father, as we lift our voices to you, God, we praise you. We honor you. We glorify you, Lord. Let us not forget, Father, thousands of years ago, you came on a colt. Let us not forget, Lord. You came for us. That was for us today. And we thank you, Lord. Because you are worthy. Oh, you're worthy. So, Lord, we ask that you would uplift the exalter that's coming, Lord. Uplift the praise and worship team on today, Lord. Father, we pray that you would be with our musicians on today as well. But as we all sing to you on today, God, be lifted up, Lord. You and you alone, God, be lifted up. Bless the man that's going to bring the word on today, Lord. Hide him behind your cross, Father. Allow your Holy Spirit to speak to us on today, God. There are hearts and minds that need you, Father. I pray, God, that they will be softened. Have your way today, Lord. We love you, Lord. We bless your holy name. Lift them up, saints. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Lord.
Hallelujah, great team. Hallelujah. Come on, you can do better than that. You can do better than that. On this Palm Sunday, you can do better than that. See, this Palm Sunday reminds us that there's hope for the hopeless. He's a friend to the friendless. Hallelujah. There's healing to those that are sick. That's what this Palm Sunday reminds us of. And greater than that, that he came for you and I. He made a way for you and I. Didn't have to. But that agape love, he put on flesh, walked amongst us. Sin not. Took on your sin, past, present, and future. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. That's why we come into the house to praise him. Not that he needs to give us anything else, because he gave you the greatest thing of all. He's given you eternal life. That's why we say, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Listen to this. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord with my life. I will sing praises to my God as long as I live. Do not put your trust in princes. Do not put your trust in princes. In other words, don't put your trust in man or woman. In mortal men who cannot save. When their spirits depart, they return to the ground. On that very day, their plans come to nothing. Blessed is he who helps us, is the God of Jacob, the maker of heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them, the Lord who remains faithful forever. Come on, people, praise him on this Palm Sunday. The maker of heaven and the earth, the creator of it all, the very breath that you have in your body don't even belong to you. Belongs to he saw fit today that you walk through those doors, come in this sanctuary, lift up your hand, shout unto him something great, because he didn't have to. We take it for granted. I just been to back-to-back funerals. We take it for granted. Everyone has a date. Everyone has a date. We don't know it, but he does. So I will give my all to him, my whole life. Every breath that I have belongs to him. That's why we praise him, not worrying about tomorrow. Tomorrow will take care of itself. We worry about today, this time, this moment that he has ordained for worship, for worship, for worship. Not for wanting stuff, but for worshiping him who deserves it. As Deacon said earlier, I know everybody weak, might have been problem going on and may not turn out the way you want to. But as he said, he allowed you to go through and get to this day. So I'm asking for the next 30 seconds or so. Let's push everything out. Clear your minds. Forget about yesterday. Forget about tomorrow. Even forget about what you're going to do after service. And let's think about this Palm Sunday. Do you realize the agony that he was going to go through for us? All he wanted to do was to establish a relationship between us and him. So let's begin to thank him for that. If he never ever blesses you again, he erased it. I have a laundry bag. I had to borrow some bags. My sin was so bad to put it in there. I couldn't hold it myself. He erased it with this now, the shedding of blood. He sprinkled it over all my stuff. And I had a lot of stuff. He sprinkled his perfect blood over all our stuff. All our stuff. Hallelujah. Hosanna. 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 Father God, we don't quite understand all what you do, but we thank you for what you did. You are just worthy of the praise, oh great God. You are just so worthy. When our toe hurt or when it don't hurt, when our money is funny, you deserve it. When our kids are acting up, you deserve it. When the job is crazy, you still deserve it. When the report come back bad, you still deserve it. You deserve it, oh great King. So we lift our voices unto you, God. Have your way in this service, oh great God. On this Palm Sunday, Father God, as the man of God come, free him up. Free him up. Free him up to speak what says the Lord. Someone here today needs to hear what says the Lord. If there be any here that do not know you, oh great God, save, save, save today. Bless our choir, Father God. Praise and worship to you, O great God. Let them sing songs of Zion. Not unto us, but unto you, O great God. For everything we do, everything that we have, everything that we are, it's because of the sacrifice you made 2,000 years ago. So we come into this house lifting holy hands and our voices unto you, O great God. Have your way. Do you love him, church? Shout unto the God with a voice of triumph. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, church. Hallelujah.
We're going to sing familiar songs, Calvary, but we're going to sing them a little different, okay? God is still worthy.
Be the rock and let the God of my salvation be exalted. blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted.
Hosanna.
Hosanna.
must you be lifted higher.
Glory to God. Sing it, Jesus.
Jesus, you be lifted higher.
Come on, let me hear you, church.
Higher, be lifted higher.
Glory to God.
Jesus, you be lifted higher.
Higher,
be lifted higher.
Can you just praise our God? Come on, wave those palms today. Some people wonder, what's this about? Well, it comes from the Bible. The people had enough sense to hail the King of Kings, at least for a little while, as he entered Jerusalem. It was a sign of laying down a carpet for a conquering a general or a ruler returning to his territory. And the goal was to make his entryway more glorious. Right, to give him more honor by blanketing, right, his path with palm branches. And the people cried out. As a matter of fact, the Bible says, on the next day, much people that were come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of palm trees and went forth to meet him and cried, Hosanna, blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord. Would you just lift yours up and just in your own way, just blessed be the King. Blessed be the Son of David. Blessed be the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Jesus, be lifted higher. Hosanna. Hosanna, which means save now. Oh, we need you, Lord God. Save now. Save our homes, God. Save our families, Lord. Save our cities, oh Lord. Save our nation. Hosanna. We bow before you and recognize that you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. There are no others. All others are pretenders to the throne. They're principalities, but you are the God of the Bible. You are from everlasting to everlasting, and you deserve our honor and our worship and our praise. Be lifted higher. Come on, lift him up high. Jesus, be lifted higher. Higher in our hearts, higher in our church, higher in our communities. We worship and praise your name. Come on, take another minute or so and just bless God. Come on, you got up and came out on a windy Sunday morning, a beautiful Lord's Day. Come on and wave that branch. Lord, we bow down before you. We acknowledge that you are King and you are Lord. We ask you to forgive us of all of our sins and all of our transgressions. We have so often, Lord, known your word and done the opposite. But you've been so kind and so merciful. You're filled with so much love for us and you shower down so much grace. We pray that you would forgive us and cleanse us of all iniquity and unrighteousness. Lord, that you would fill us with thy spirit and that you would teach us thy word. Lord, we give you honor. We've come to worship. That's why we're here. So we lift up our hands in the sanctuary and bless the Lord. We wave these branches, oh Lord, just kind of as a symbol that you are King and Lord, and that we want everything, your entryway into our lives and through our lives, Lord, to be filled with humility. So we lay these down before you. We declare that you are King and that you are Lord. Anybody believe me this morning? Anybody with me? Jesus is Lord and Lord of all. There's a whole bunch of folk that want to say they're God and they're King and think they're something, but the Bible says you shouldn't think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. He is King and he is Lord. I'm glad about that. He's bigger than America. He's bigger than the planet. He's bigger than the universe. He is the God who created all these things and he deserves our praise. Come on, another 60 seconds. Would you just bow before the King? It's a shame to come to church and don't bow down before the King. And I don't necessarily even mean physically, but in your heart, is he Lord? Is he King? Does he speak and you say, yes, sir. Yes, master. Thy servant hears and thy servant will obey. Because if we're not doing that, Jesus said, there are many that will say in that day, Lord, Lord. And I'll say, I did not know you. You know why? Because they didn't do the stuff he said. Faith without works is dead. Are you a follower of Christ? Are you willing to give everything in pursuit of Him? And when you fail, because we all do you repent? Do you bow down and say, Lord, forgive me for my transgressions and my iniquities? Lord, I pray that there's any here today who have not been saved, that you'd save them right now. And I pray, Lord, that there's any in this room today or under the sound of our voices today that cannot say in their souls, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed be he who cometh in the name of the Lord. That you would do that in us today. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. We're glad about that. We're glad that Christ gave himself up for us. We're grateful that Christ bore our sins and died for us. We're grateful that as Pastor reminded us, all of our sins have been washed away. Anybody still glad about that? In the blood of Jesus Christ, all of our sins. And we are grateful, as we'll celebrate next week, Lord willing, that you did not stay in the grave, but you rose again on the third day. You're alive. Hallelujah. And because you got up, we will get up too. So we bless you in the sanctuary. Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. You are King of kings and Lord of lords. We lift you up and we extol you. We say, praise God. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. We love you. We need you. Do in us today whatever it is you want to do. Whatever you need to shift and change in this ministry or in us as individuals in order to please you, please do that. Because that's the best thing for us. Those whose heads are bowed down, those who are anxious and worried about many things, meet them here today, Lord. And help them at a minimum simply to see that you're bigger than whatever they're going through. That there's every reason for them to rejoice today because their joy doesn't come from their circumstances. Their joy comes from the risen Christ. Bless you and thank you in Jesus' name. And all the people of God said, amen. Amen. Come on and go ahead and hug about 20 folk. Just wish them a very happy Palm Sunday. Thank you so much for the praise team this morning. Appreciate y'all so much. Hallelujah. Hosanna. Love that. Higher, be it higher. Jesus, you be lifted. Be lifted. I hear you singing at home, Mignon. I can hear you. Glory to your name. Glory to your name. Hosanna. 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 Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, saving us from our sin, the penalty, the right and just penalty thereof. Thank you, Lord, for your blood being poured out, washing all of our iniquity away. Thank you, Father, for sending the Son. Thank you, Comforter, Holy Spirit, who lives in us. Happy Palm Sunday, brother. Hey, sweet pea. Hey, oh my gracious. Oh my goodness. Hey, beautiful. Oh, come on now. Don't get me crying. I got to preach. Oh, boy. Man. Welcome, 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 saints. My goodness. Glad y'all are here. Thank you, Jesus. What a week. What a week coming as well. Thank you, Lord. Those of you checking in on YouTube and other places, thank y'all too. Keep forgetting about y'all. Thank you. People in other states hanging out with us. Thank you so much. Those at home dealing with illness, thank you for hanging out with us online. Praise God. Amen. Good morning, CRC. Amen. That's right. Y'all too low. Good morning, CRC.
Good morning.
Amen. It's good to see everybody. Wonderful Palm Sunday. I was growing up, I used to love Palm Sundays because I got a tree branch when I got to church. And, you know, we're just continuing the tradition. It's just a reminder that when we read these narratives, they're not just made up stories. They're real. They're true. The Lord really did enter Jerusalem, and the people at least had enough clarity in the moment to acknowledge that the Messiah was, the King was coming. Now, of course, it's not only a symbol, you know, of the majesty of our God, just laying down something humble before him, you know, as he entered into the holy city. But it's also a reminder of the fickleness of humanity, because it wasn't but just a few days later where many of those who had laid down this branch and said, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord, acknowledging that he was from the line of David, acknowledging that he was the king that have come to save them. Some of them same folk turned around and said, crucify him, give us Barabbas. And so it's a reminder of several things. And so we hope that the lesson is made and that you'll at least take this home. And if there's anybody in your household, you see you walk in with a branch, what's that about? What an opportunity to share the gospel. Amen. Amen. So we're grateful that you are here today. Y'all love the Lord. Okay, we got a big week coming up. It always is. A start of Holy Week is traditionally today as we kind of track along with the last 7 days of our Lord's earthly ministry before his crucifixion and resurrection. And so this week, if you are want to, you can sign up for our monthly or our weekly newsletter. You can go to our website, click the newsletter, and you'll be in that, or sign up for our text messages, because this week we'll be sending out daily. I think it starts today or tomorrow, but we'll be sending out some videos for you each day to track along with where our Lord was and what our Lord was doing according to the Gospels. And so you can add that into your family worship this week. And so if you're not kind of hooked into the text messaging thing that we do every once in a while, or at least our email/newsletter, then we encourage you to do that. And then something a little different for our church. We haven't done this, I don't know when was the last time we did this, but we're having a Good Friday service right here at the church this upcoming Friday. Amen. That's a good clap. Amen. And I know it's a bit of a break in routine, but I'm asking you to break your routine. I know, how many of you know sometimes it can be really hard for us to break our routines? It can be very, very difficult, but I'm asking you to break your routine and meet us here on Friday night from 7 to 8. It's just going to be some readings, some exhortation, a little singing concerning Good Friday, our Lord's suffering, our Lord's passion, and what he went through for us. And then we're going to come in on Sunday morning, Lord willing, and bring everybody you know, and we're going to preach the word of God and rejoice in his resurrection. Anybody glad he's alive? Amen. So it's a good week for us. You get to track along each week. And so if you're one of those people that kind of just check in on Sunday, this is a good time to break that pattern as well. Just, you know, on Monday, there'll be something. On Tuesday, there'll be something. On Wednesday, there'll be something. And then you get to come and pray and sing a little bit, at least for an hour or so on Friday evening. And then again, of course, he was in the tomb on Saturday, and then into the resurrection service on Sunday, the time that we're celebrating. And of course, there'll be somebody said, well, you know, the dates are wrong. Look, I don't care. Just we celebrate. Okay, just we're going to celebrate. This is the time we're marking out to celebrate, right? And so we're going to celebrate. Amen. And so I'm glad about that. I'm glad he's risen. Amen. So hopefully all of you are prepared for that. And like I said last week, this is a time of year where folks that don't typically go to church, but they will somehow, for some reason, go on Easter or Resurrection Sunday, and they will also go many times on Christmas. So in the back, we have some handouts, some little very nice invite cards. They match the colors of our spring kind of colors, and they're really nice. But here's the thing. If you don't take them today, we lost money. Right? I mean, we lost money. We believe in good stewardship, so you got to take them today because they got like dates on them, so they become obsolete after this week. So you got to take them today, and then don't just take them, but give them out and invite your neighbors. You might be surprised. They may come. They may come next Sunday, and so we want to have a day where we're going to be right in Hebrews, but we're going to be talking about the hardness of men's heart. The very next verse, Hebrews 3:7, just tailor-made for a Resurrection Sunday morning. And so if you know someone who's willing to come to church and you also suspect that they really need the gospel, then it'll be a wonderful time for them to receive that this upcoming Sunday. So God is good. Amen? All right. You got your Bibles? Amen. Well, let's open up to Hebrews chapter 3. Have some fun at the end of service today, so stick around when we're done with the message and we're done with the Lord's table. We are also bringing up and introducing to you some new members who are in the house today. Amen. And so as we will lay hands on them right at close, as you guys will come up and greet them, and then there'll be some food in the back. And I asked Pastor Prophet this morning, I said, man, where did you get the food from this time? Because you never know where he's going to get the food from. You just never know. It could be Wawa. I mean, you never know where it's coming from. And I said, what is it going to be? He said, it's chicken sandwiches and fish sandwiches. I said, wow. I said, where'd you get that from? I was suspecting something I knew. He said, the place was called like Scrimps something. Scrimp Shack. I said, wait a minute. I said, so somebody took how we say the word and turned that into, he said, yeah. I was like, okay, only you can find that. Scrimp Shack. Bless the Lord. So we'll pray over the food and all that at the end. Hebrews chapter. Those of you visiting with us, I hope you feel welcome. I hope you're saying with all your heart, you are welcome. We love you. We're so glad that you're with us today. Welcome to Calvary Reformation Church. We're going to Hebrews chapter 3. We're going to read from King James up front. We like a lot of different versions. We just typically preach from King James. I've just gone back to my roots as I've gotten more gray hair. I don't know why. But we're going to start in verse 1 again, but our focus today is in verse 6. So Deacon Will is going to help me read, and the Bible says,
wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Jesus Christ, who was faithful to him that appointed him, as also Moses was faithful in all his house. Mm. For this man was counted worthy of more glory than Moses, insomuch as he who hath builded the house hath more honor than the house.
Amen.
For every house is builded by some man, but he that built all things is God. And Moses verily was faithful in all his house, as a servant, for a testimony of those things which were to be spoken after. But Christ, as a son over his own house, whose house are we, if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm unto the end.
Let me read that last verse one more time. But Christ, as a son over his own house, whose house are we? Just find three people and ask them, are you part of God's house? Two more folk, are you in the house? All right. If, that's a big word there, conjunction, junction, what's your function? If we hold, Hebrews is like that. Hebrews messes with us a little bit. If we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm unto the end, just for a few moments, brothers and sisters, the book of Hebrews, chapter 3, verse 6, members of God's household. Members of God's household. Let's pray. Father, once again, thank you for sending your son to do for us what we could never have done on our own. Thank you for sending the Holy One, born of a virgin, living out the perfect life in our place, going to the cross and dying for our sins, your wrath being poured out upon the Son, that we, by grace and through faith, would have access to the tree of life. We're overwhelmed by that, Lord, particularly when you bring it back to our remembrance and we can hush the voices of the day and all the other things that call for our attention and just focus on the fact that you loved us so much that you died for us, that you went down into the grave and that you, after you were buried, went down to the grave and rose again on the third day. And so, Father, thank you for that. Thank you for sending the Son. Lord Christ, thank you for who you are and what you've done. Now, please teach us your word. Send your spirit, O Lord. Send the anointing that teaches us all things. We men, we're so mistake prone, we're so fallible. And so this time is a time again where we need you. We need you to take control of the preacher and the ears and the eyes of the hearer, so that we leave not having heard the opinions of men, but rather we leave today having heard the voice of our God. We need you. Bless now this time, sanctify this time, build up your people, correct us as necessary, and we'll give you praise in it all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Please take your seats. Once again, thank you all so much. Again, let's go to work this week. Let's be active this week. Let's invite everybody this week. Let's kind of explode into Holy Week, really digging into the Gospels, digging into those videos. And, you know, there's more important things going on than your favorite TV shows. This is a great week to kind of reset and refocus. Amen? Amen. All right. So if you look at your notes, I kind of already did that initial part there where we kind of in the midst of exhortation. Again, happy Palm Sunday to you. I want to take you right into verse number 6 today. And as I said last week, I know these notes are getting longer. I'm trying. I tried so hard this week, and this is the best I can do. So we're going to do our best. We're going to do our best today with it. But there's so much. Anybody realize that there's just so much richness in God's word? And then, and of course, he loves his people so much. I get into this thing and I think, man, there's so much to talk about. There's so many good and godly things that can bring encouragement to God's people. So I hope you receive many of those things today. Verse 6, one more time from Hebrews chapter 3. But Christ as a son over his own house, whose house are we if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm unto the end. I just kind of desired to just break the verse down this week, really nothing more complicated than that, and reviewing a little bit from last week, this entire narrative concerning Moses. We looked at that last week. We tried to extrapolate some life lessons from the faithfulness of Moses, being faithful over God's house or within God's house or concerning God's people, as we made the point last week. Now, again, from last week, we said that there are many titles in Scripture for the local assembly. And today, in these texts, we see this nomenclature of a house, which, as all the titles are, you know, it's significant. When God calls us an army, that means something. That's significant. When he calls us brethren, you know, that's significant. When he calls us a bride, that has a spiritual connotation and is very significant. Likewise, when he calls us a house, that is also significant. The word here for house in Greek is oikos, which can mean a physical structure, but metaphorically here can mean God's family or God's people. And so when God says that we are his house, he doesn't obviously mean that we're wood and shingles and hinges. He means that we are his people. Are you with me so far? And you know what, beloved? I may say this a couple times today, we'll see. But one of the issues that we have often is we don't see ourselves increasingly the way God sees us. Often we struggle with some identity issues, and often who we are is more a function of what TikTok and Instagram says than what God says, or what our checkbook says, or what somebody who doesn't know the Lord, what words they have put upon us as opposed to the words that God has put upon us. And so in the descriptor here, house has, I think, some meaning. And it's not that deep when you think about what is a house, what happens in a house. Anybody glad to live in a home, right? We all live somewhere. We're not even talking about the structure of, we're not talking about a 4-bedroom, 2.5-bath. We're talking about you live somewhere. You came from somewhere. And so house, to me, merits a little work here. Number one, a house is where we live. It's where we dwell. So we think, wow, do we live in God? Do we dwell in God? We are his house. A house is where we typically are refreshed and find rest. It is our home. We'll see this term rest comes up in Hebrews, but are we resting in the promises of our God? Are the things of God like being at home? Are you comfortable with righteousness and what flows out of the scripture, or is it still alien to you? A house often denotes family and lineage. When we think of house, we often, you know, think of the houses we've lived in the state of our family, and it's where we find purpose. It's where we learn who we are. We learn what our name is in the house. Anybody old enough to remember that family lineage was so important that you were taught not to bring shame to the family name? That's all kind of gone away now. But we need a little bit of that, I think. We need a little bit of that back. But a house often denotes family and lineage, and we'll talk more about that as we go along today. A house is where we find shelter and protection. Praise God. We're called here Christ's house or God's house, and I'm just taking the word house and just pulling a few things out of it. A house is where we find shelter, is where we find protection? Is this where you find shelter and protection in all things Jesus Christ? And then a house is a place of peace and rejoicing. It's where there's fellowship and intimacy, is where there is memory and meaning. And I'm just submitting to you right off the top that we don't often see ourselves as members of God's household. We say we can see ourselves as members of the church. We kind of throw the title Christian around, but we don't actually really kind of understand, I think, sometimes what that means. It's more of a statement of belief, which is okay, but it's also a statement concerning life and how we live it. God's house is very similar. You are a member of God's household if you are a believer in Jesus Christ. And that implies great privilege, but it also implies great responsibility. That's why the scripture here, says we're going to find out, says we're members of his house if, and so we'll talk a little bit about if. That word if is a dangerous word. And so a house is where we live, it's where we dwell, it suggests a certain joy. A house is where we typically refreshed, and it's home. A house denotes family and lineage. Do you see this body as your brothers and sisters? I've come to realize that oftentimes, you know, it's you feel as if the spiritual bond is closer than the blood bond. Because there's a spiritual bond, because we're all lined up in Jesus, and there may be some blood relatives that you love, but they're crazy. Talk to me, somebody. I mean, you love them, you go into the family reunion, but you're not calling them for advice. And if they don't repent and believe, that relationship will be severed at some future point. When we die or the Lord comes back, and my spiritual brothers and sisters and I, we're going to be together forever. You ain't never getting rid of me. I mean, if I go down to the grave, I mean, you'll get rid of me for a little while, but I'll see you soon. And what a day of rejoicing it will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory. And that is the hallelujah, by the way. But am I the only one excited today about just being alive in Jesus? But that is the spiritual inheritance of all the saints of God, despite what goes on in the world. And we all have that as believers, so that we are bound by one Father, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. We are brothers and sisters in the same house. We have the same Father. That's why you can't drag me out of church on a Sunday. I need my brothers and sisters. I'm too crazy. I need all of y'all. Help me, please. I need all of y'all. That's another story. We'll talk about that more in Hebrews as well. I never understand this last lackadaisical attitude concerning the Lord's day. You get to meet with your family and worship your Father. It's amazing. We're the house of Christ, the house of God, where we find shelter and protection. The house is a place of peace and rejoicing. And so, the Father, through the Son and by the Holy Spirit, provides all of these things for us as we look today at being members of God's household. And now, if we backtrack just a little bit, there's a flow of thought here in Hebrews, all the way from chapter 1, but there's a flow of thought here even in chapter number 3. In Hebrews 3:3, Jesus is referred to as the builder of the house. This is why we said last week that he deserves more glory than Moses. Moses was faithful over God's house, but Jesus is the builder of the house. Moses had commands to carry out, but Jesus is the one issuing those commands. This is why he deserves more glory than Moses, who was a part of the house. Christ is the builder. Say that with me. Christ is the builder. And verse 4 reminds us that God uses people to build, but the ultimate builder is God himself. Christ is God the Son, the true builder, whereas Moses was simply an instrument of God's building. And so that was kind of our message last week. We looked at Moses, took a life profile of him, looked at some of the faithfulness, and this is brought up in this text for a reason. Remember the context of Hebrews, the author talking to a mostly Jewish or a mostly Hebrew audience, and so far he's talked about angels, he's talked about Abraham, now he brings Moses in because he's trying to use all the things they know and point them to Jesus as the greater and as the anti-type of the fulfillment of so many of these things, and he'll continue to do that all throughout the book of Hebrews. But Christ is the builder. One more time. Christ is the builder. Say it again. Christ is the builder. We are members of the household of God, but Christ is the one who prepares the soil. Christ is the foundation. All these things are Just helping us to remember that he is greater than Moses in context. Christ is the rock. And I couldn't, as I was thinking about these things, I couldn't pass up the chance to quote one of my favorite scriptures in Matthew 7. Read, sir.
Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house. And it fell not, for it was founded upon the rock.
By the way, pause there. How many of you want to build your house on the rock? Anybody live long enough to see what happens when your house ain't built? I said ain't built on the rock. Anybody been around long enough to see what happens when your relationship, when your money, when your church, and maybe you had it on the rock for a while but had a better plan and took it off the rock. God has a way of testing the surety of your foundation. Keep reading, sir.
And everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man.
Interesting, that word in Greek for foolish is moroni, where we get the word moron. Keep going, sir.
Which built his house upon the sand, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it.
Christ is not only the builder, Christ is the foundation. And so he commands us to build on the rock. How do we build on the rock? We build on the rock by doing what he told us to do. When we hear the word of God and actually do what the word of God says, we are constructing, we are building, we are being built upon the rock. And the rains will come and the floods will come and the winds will blow. It's amazing how the weather can give us an illustration. And the winds will blow and the house might shake a little bit, but it's not going to fall because it's founded upon the rock. But that other person, the foolish man, whose house is built on sand, that is to say the word of God came and we're not going to do that, that's living life on the sand. And when things start to happen in the world with the rain and the wind and all of that, then you know, we'll all kind of figure out what's going on because the thing will crash. Okay? And so Christ is the constructor. Christ puts the piece together. Christ assembles us and sustains us. He is building us. Read, sir, from Matthew 16.
And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church.
Build my church.
And the gates of hell shall not prevail against
thee. That's right.
And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven.
I don't know about you, but I want to be a part of what Christ is building. Now, some of you are saying, yes, well, if you're a Christian, you're a part of the church. Yes, you are a part of the church. I'm not disputing that in any shape or form. You are being built as an individual believer. Bless the Lord. But the bulk of the New Testament evidence when word church is used or implied is about the local assembly. So I would say, yes, individually, you are being built. Thank God he's building you. Anybody glad he's building you? Amen. Right? But boy, I tell you what, it sure is a whole lot easier when you're in the company of your brothers and sisters. And not a lone ranger somewhere getting beat on by the devil. You know, don't think you're going to take on the gates of hell by yourself. Okay, all right. And so the Lord is the constructor. The Lord is putting the pieces together. The Lord is the builder. And guess what, beloved? We are who Christ is building. Just still working through those first few verses there before we get down to verse number 6 from last week. Again, just a little bit of review. We are who Christ is building. Again, if we look at the example that the author gives us the example of Moses. We know that the law came through Moses. And when Moses was on Mount Sinai for all of those days and nights, he didn't just give him the Decalogue or the Ten Commandments, but he gave him this extreme level of detail concerning many things, not the least of which would be the tent of meeting or the tabernacle structure. And I just right here recall the intricacies of the construction of the physical house that Moses built. Nothing was left to human imagination. God gave instruction about dimensions. They just couldn't wing it. God gave instruction about color, about material, what kind of tools you were supposed to use, where you put the furniture. He commanded the specific people that were to be used, this family and this one, do this throughout Exodus and Leviticus, how they were to be anointed, how they were to be dressed, what they were supposed to do and when. And we use that as an opportunity to say, and we think in the New Testament, grace means that there are no commands for us, that we can just kind of do whatever we want and blame the Holy Spirit. So that we need to check that attitude. But God is also familiar with the intricate details of everything that you're going through. He knows, as he's building you, he knows all about your life. He knows where you are. He knows how you feel. Beloved, you're not alone. He'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. Well, you don't understand, Bishop. I may not, but he does. And he's with you right now. And we'll talk as we go through this today. We'll see hopefully some encouragement for you in this regard. But that God is building you, and he is concerned about the intricacies of your life too. My pastor taught me this. I said, he asked me, did you pray about that one? This many years ago. Did you pray about that? I said, no, that's too small. I mean, God's name. He said, are you serious? Boy, hush. God cares about everything you're going through. He cares about you. It's nothing too small to talk to your father about. The same God who gave Moses this intricate level of detail is building you. Nothing is left to chance in your life either. We don't always understand the sovereignty of God and how that plays out day to day, but we can trust that he's sovereign. Can you just lift one hand right there and say, thank you, Lord. There are things in my life where I go, I don't know why that is, but I know God's in control. Glory to God. So even where you are right now, he is sovereignly ordering and ordaining things for his own glory. And you may not, somebody needs to hear this today, and you may not be able to see how your pain connects with his glory. And you may not see that until you're in glory. I would just admonish you, based on the scriptures, to lift your hands anyway and say, blessed be the name of the Lord. In this life, we'll have tribulation and trouble. Right? It's what we've been told. And so, blessed be the name of the Lord. What does it do for your soul to know that God is building you now? That you're a member of his household, and that he's building you because he's building his church. He hasn't stopped building his church. You're a part of. What does it do for us collectively to know that he's building us? Sending words and things for us, for our exhortation and our correction, for his own glory. In other words, God isn't just sitting in heaven and he pushed a button, you know, several thousand years ago and is aloof. God is moving amongst us now, ordering and ordaining and for his own glory. That gives me a lot of hope, particularly when I turn on the news and I go, whoo, Lord, I don't know about that, but I know you're good. So help me to know what I'm supposed to know so that I'm able to do what you want me to do while you're building us. So as we said last week, Moses was faithful in delivering and leading God's house, his people, verse 5. But Moses' work was an illustration of the truths that God would reveal later, the NLT says in that verse, because the type of who Moses was, i.e. the earthly deliverer, would give way to the anti-type or the fulfillment, which would be, of course, the everlasting deliverer or Christ, the lesser Moses, pointing us to the greater, our Lord Jesus. And so Moses was faithful to God's call in context to deliver his people from Egypt, to sanctify them through God's law, and to glorify them in a land flowing with milk and honey, all wonderful things. But Christ would accomplish these things, not just temporarily, but spiritually and eternally. Moses was faithful to lead God's people, God's house as directed, and his faithfulness resulted in bodily freedom from slavery. Somebody say amen. But Jesus is also faithful to lead his people, but his faithfulness results in spiritual freedom from sin. Say amen. Now, which one is greater, bodily freedom from slavery or spiritual freedom from sin? The lesser is always gives way to the greater. And as badly as we want things to order itself rightly physically, the greater is obvious. This freedom that we have from sin, death, and hell, from being snatched out of the hand of the devil and being translated into the kingdom of light. Hallelujah to God. So even if that means that I need to go through a few things physically, well, praise your name, but no one can snatch me out of his hand. And as we said many times, Jesus is enough. And one of the kind of reasons why the church often struggles is because we're trying to build an earthly kingdom, not understanding that Christ is king over all things and is ushering us into a heavenly kingdom. Are we supposed to take ground here? Shout yes. But we do that with a motivation that's spiritual in nature. If our motivation to take ground here is what we're going to get here, we've lost it somewhere. If I'm going to get a house, I'm going to get land, I'm going to get that stuff's temporary. Get it, manage it, pass it on. But your most important legacy is the spiritual one. So this is good, and this is far greater. Amen. I want to have a physical body to get in the gym, need to work out, need to eat better, Done lost all y'all now? Need to get my steps in? Need to push weight? Trying to, but oh man, that's valuable, but not as valuable as knowing that I've been given eternal life. And I need to feed my spirit and cultivate my soul. And this is of greater value than this, even though this has value. Moses' ministry had much value. Christ is just greater. Oh, glory to God. He's just greater. And so as you break down this verse, verse 6, one more time, it starts out, but Christ as a son. So we're just taking the phrases and just talking through them very quickly. Breaking down the verse, Christ as a son. In the flow of thought in Hebrew so far, we've seen that angels are servants in God's house. So we see that in chapter 1. We are servants in God's house. It flips around and talks a little bit about us in chapter 2. Abraham was a servant in God's house. Again, used to draw in kind of the Jewish hearer to help them understand that things aren't being thrown away, just fulfilled. Moses was a servant in God's house. But Christ as a son is in charge of God's entire house, the way that the New Living Translation said it. You might recall the parable of the wicked tenants when we were working our way through Matthew 21. The householder who planted the vineyard eventually sent his son. You remember? A man planted a vineyard called the householder in the King James, and lent it out, or had some people working the land for him, and he decides he wants to call them to account and get some of the fruit of what belongs to him. And so he sends the servant with the people who he had lent the land out to, or rented the land out to, decided, you know, they got a big head about it and said, no, we work in this land, we're going to keep this. And so they kill the servant. So he sends another servant, and they kill that servant. So he sends another servant, and they kill that servant. And he says, you know what, I'm going to send my son, because they'll respect my son. And they don't. They don't respect the son. Their heart was to kill the son too, and the parable pronounces judgment on those who would kill the son. The point is, the author does not want the son put in the same category as the servants. The servants, the angels, ministering spirits, chapter 1, us, we're servants in the house of God, thank God. Abraham was a servant. Moses was a servant, but the son is different. The son is different. The son is greater. The son owns the house. Amen. The son is the heir, going back to the parable. The son is the heir. The son deserves more honor and more reverence than the servants. And in a day where blasphemy is popular and heresy is all the rage, I don't know if you guys keep up with what's going on in the church world on YouTube and social media. I mean, goodness, just this last week, some preacher somewhere was saying, "What if God worships me?" Good gravy. And somebody sent me that clip, and this dude is honestly preaching that. I'm like, man, get a haircut and stop blaspheming. But that's your bishop. That's who I am. I'm like, what are you doing? If God worships you, what are you talking? It's so much blasphemy. It's so much heresy going on today. It's good to be reminded of the person and work and the nature of Jesus Christ. We worship one God revealed in three persons. The second member of the Godhead is Jesus, the Son of God. He is God the Son, fully divine and the Son of God. Let's read a couple of verses here just to remind us of this truth. Read, sir, from John 1.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. A reference, of course, to the Lord Jesus, if you keep reading in John 1. But let's look at John 8 now, verse 58.
Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am.
A statement of deity, if I've ever seen one, using the I am statement of Jehovah, which, of course, is Christ. And if you look at this idea that he is not just God the Son, but he's also the Son of God, fully human, taking on a human nature at what's called the incarnation, or being born of a virgin. Jesus has two natures in one person. Theologians call it the hypostatic union. He's not half God and half man. This isn't Hercules, right? This isn't Greek mythology, but he is fully God and fully man. Somebody say amen. Amen. At the incarnation, he added a human nature to his divine nature for our sakes. Why? So that he could be at all points tempted and identify with us in our weakness, so that he could be our faithful and merciful high priest. His natures aren't mixed together. They're separate, but yet act as a unit. Born of a virgin, born of a woman, had a human genealogy, had a body, had the common experiences of humanity, including sorrow and growing as from a young boy, and hunger and sleep and et cetera. So he is the Son of God. He is also God the Son, and he is greater than the servants in the house. He indeed is the builder and owner and foundation of the house, and he is the only savior from sin. Acts 4:10.
Be it known unto you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you whole. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which is to become the head of the corner.
Love that.
Neither is there salvation in any other.
No others, y'all.
For there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved.
That's worth an amen right there. There's no other name given under heaven whereby men must be saved. Do you still believe that? Do you still believe that there's no other way to heaven but by the name and through the blood of Jesus Christ? Do you still believe that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except by him? Do you still believe that everyone outside of that ark of safety is going to hell? Then, beloved, we ought to be preaching our little hearts out. We ought to be preaching our little hearts out. We ought to be telling everybody that message. Now, will that message get you in trouble? Shout yes. I mean, this is, again, heresy is rampant, blasphemy is rampant, sometimes even in the church, but there is no other name under heaven given whereby men must be saved but the name of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, Son of God and God the Son, is King and Lord. He is King of kings and Lord of lords. He's bigger than our government. He's bigger than our country. He's bigger than everything. Every knee will bow. Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. Buddha isn't Lord. Muhammad isn't Lord. He's not the spirit brother of Lucifer. He's not Michael the archangel. He is the Son of God and God the Son. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And we need more boldness with this message, not less. Boldness doesn't mean unloving. It just means you stand strongly in what's true. We need more of this, not less. We need to look at folks and say, man, I love you, but let me declare to you today that if you die today in your sin without confessing that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and believing in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you are not saved. Saved from what? Saved from the wrath of Almighty God, the just wrath of God poured out upon rebels. I ain't no rebel. You most certainly are, and proved it by saying I ain't no rebel. I was a rebel, an enemy of God. I needed to be shown my sin by the Spirit of God and brought to my knees by the grace of God. And then I can lift my hands because he gave me faith enough to believe and say, forgive me, Lord, a sinner. The gospel is not about your business. The gospel is not about your BMW. The gospel is not about your Facebook followers. The gospel is about Christ the Son coming to this earth, dying on the cross, and rising again on the third day so that we can survive the day of judgment. This is the Son we're talking about here. We are members. When we say yes to Jesus, we become members of the household of God. And there are truths here embedded in this text to rejoice over. Number one, the house belongs to God. Number two, Christ has been given all things. Number three, Christ therefore is head of the house. He's head of the house. And you're a member of that house. Well, are all those things biblically true? Yeah, I believe so. Come on, let's read a little bit. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15.
But if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God.
It's called the house of God. That means God owns the house, which is the church of the living God. That is where we are right now. Everybody who's in a legit church, in a true church, right, is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of truth. I love that. That, you know what that says to me as a preacher? It says that if you're getting false anywhere else, you don't come into the church and get false. You come into the church and get true. And sometimes that truth has us dancing. And sometimes that truth has us ready to get up and walk out. I remember, we got time for a quick C story. I remember a ministry story. I remember this clear as day. Thinking about this morning, so it came back up. But several years ago, I was having an exit interview with some folks that were leaving the church, sitting in my office. And they were particularly the wife at the time, but they were very upset with me. and which is pretty common. And I'm sitting there and I'm going, well, what's the problem? I said, well, I don't like that you taught blah, 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 blah. And I'm going, okay, all right. Well, we both got Bibles here. You want to go? No, I don't want to do all that. Well, okay, well, can you at least, I'm a man, so I might err. So can you at least tell me where my fault is in my exegesis, in my historical application? You know, where did I err? And it ain't about all that. So did I say something wrong? It ain't even wrong. I just don't like it. Okay. It just does something in my spirit. You know how we can spiritualize stuff when we want to rebel? And I said, okay, and I shouldn't have said this, but I did. I said, okay, well, you know, I have a way for you for all those feelings to go away. Obedience is an option. One of the options here is, in fact, to obey. You ain't got to sit there with a pouty face. You can get free by doing what God said. And they left. But the church is that place where humbly you go, did I err? Did I mess up? Did I do something wrong so I can repent? No? Well, then the pillar and ground of truth is saying, be obedient. Because that's where the blessing, the freedom, the love of you love. And no, that didn't work out too good. She did not want to think that obedience was an actual option. Right? But that's what the church does. Matthew 11, read, sir.
All things are delivered unto me of my Father, and no man knoweth the Son but the Father. Neither knoweth any man the Father save the Son, and he to whomsoever the Son.
All things. So God owns the house. It's the household of God, right? The church of the living God, but all things have been delivered to Christ. John 3:35, sir.
For the Father loveth the Son and hath given him all things into his hand.
That's right. So all things have been given into the hand of our Lord, right? So Ephesians 1, verse 20.
Which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, mm-hmm. not only in this world, but also in that which is to come.
And hath put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things of church. So I'm just, as we're looking at this part of him being the son over his own house, I just want you to see that it's God's house, but it's also the son's house. The son owns the house. The son builds the house. The son has been given the house. So we're members of God's household. That's a truth. It's also a truth to say we're members of the household of Christ because we serve one God revealed in three persons and all things have been given over to the son. I love this. From Philippians 2, I'll read it, sir. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on the cross. Wherefore, what?
God
hath highly what? Exalted him and given him, come on, help me, name that is what?
Above
every name. I love that, by the way. I need that reminder every once in a while when I'm upset because somebody's name is up there. No, well, Christ's name is over here. And I don't like what they're doing that Christ's name is over here. Yeah, you may be the president, but there's a name above every name. Yeah, you may be the senator, but there's a name above every name. Yeah, you may be able to pass a wicked law, but there's a name above every name to whom you will give an account. Because Christ is Lord means that. Christ is Lord. Now, people take issue with me. No. I mean, he's Lord in the church. But I mean, the government, no, sweetie. No, sir. Jesus is Lord of all. And just because we're acting rebellious doesn't mean there won't be a day of judgment, a day of reckoning, a day of recompense. And so if I'm in charge of something, whether I'm home as a father or in the church as an elder or a pastor or in the civil sphere, man, I'm trembling because I'm going to give an account to the Lord. So it may not happen in my lifetime. You might seem to get away with it. Yep, y'all butchering babies and shouting about it. You're going to give an account for that foolishness. I'm trying to stop you. I'm trying to vote against you. I'm trying to put my money. But if it seems like if I can't stop you, that's all right. There's a name above every name. And that make folk mad. I mean, if you've been there, there's forgiveness, there's healing, there's hope, you know, on the individual level. But as we talk about policy and so forth, that's a wicked policy. And there's a name above every name. Wherefore God has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, some knees.
Every knee.
Doesn't matter your melanin. Doesn't matter your age. Doesn't matter what part of the world you were born in. Every knee should bow in things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth. And every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. He's Lord. Amen. So the house belongs to him. Colossians 1, I got a lot of my favorites in here today. Colossians 1, 15, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities and powers. All things were created by him and what?
For
him. He is before all things, and in him all things consist. Talking about Jesus. And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. Yeah, the house is his. He's the son over his house. Son over God's house, son over his own house. I think they both are true. Okay? And so the first point was Christ as his son, just reminding you. The second point was that this is his house. He is the head over everything. We are in his house. The third point is, again, we are the house. Now, of course, he owns the cattle on a thousand hills. He owns the trees. He owns everything. But particularly in our verse and context, he's talking about us. He's talking about the church. And although we don't deserve God's mercy and grace in Christ, we have been made sons and daughters, as Pastor Prophet likes to say. We are his children. That's worth half a hallelujah right there. We are joint heirs with Christ. We are members of God's household. Wait a minute. How am I even let in the house as wicked as I am? Anybody ever been astonished at God's grace? I'm supposed to be outside the house in the doghouse in the back if I'm even allowed on the property. But here I am, not just in the house, but a member of the house, whose house we are. You, as a believer, are members of God's household. Your name has been changed. Your lineage has been changed. Who you are now connects with the King of the universe. It's right here. Read, sir. 1 Corinthians 3.
For we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building.
Ye are God's building. Ye, meaning the Corinthians. Ye through them, also meaning all of us who would believe. How does this happen? According to the grace of God, Paul says, which is given to me as a wise master builder. He said, I've laid the foundation and another buildeth thereon, but let every man take heed how he buildeth thereon, for other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Ye are God's building, the foundation of which is Christ himself. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 16, know ye not that ye are the temple of God? What? Do you see yourself like that? Now, nothing here is meant to make you arrogant or prideful. It's meant to humble us and cause us to walk a certain way, right, for the glory of God. Ye are the temple of God. You are. I am. The Corinthians were. The Ephesians were. All the believers are. We are the temple of God. Why? How? What? Huh? And that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you. That's why you're the temple of God. He lives in you. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 16, sir.
And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols?
Hey, there's a responsibility here. Keep reading, sir.
For ye are the temple of the living God, and as God hath said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people.
And then some verses that we almost can't believe are in the New Testament. Wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. An Old Testament quote brought into the New for our edification. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19. Now, therefore, ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and what? The household of God. And are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth into an holy temple. What kind of temple? What kind of house? A holy one in the Lord, in whom ye also are builded together for an habitation of God through the Spirit. The church, by its very nature, the called out ones, is supposed to be different. The ones made holy by Jesus are gathering. The temples of God are coming together as one temple to worship him. And then we scatter, but we don't leave the Holy Spirit here. We're the temple of God on our jobs. And we're the temple of God on Facebook. And we're the temple of God at Walmart. Right? We are God's household. 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 2. As newborn babes, desire the sincere miracle of the word, that ye may grow thereby. If so be ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious, to whom coming as unto a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious, ye also are lively stones. Most versions here say living. I like the King James, though. Lively stones are built up a spiritual house and holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. You know what? I mean, if you actually applied that, I don't know how you can't have a godly marriage right there. I mean, just in knowing who you are. Because that impacts what kind of wife you are. You're a priest, right? You're a holy priesthood. You're a spiritual house. And the master has given you wifely instructions in order to build up the house and make it good. You're a priest as a husband. Your spiritual house, so you're to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ, and that impacts your thinking and your speech and your giving and your... Here's my point ultimately today. Often we don't live like members of the house. But the house is blessed. And the house is strong, and the house has blessing attached to it. Parents, wave at me, parents. Have you ever withheld some of the blessings of the house because your children weren't acting right? But they still wanted the blessings. And they were acting a little funny because they expected the blessing. And were looking at you crazy because you didn't give the blessing. Well, wait a minute. Y'all know the house rules. And the house rules state ... And y'all didn't do any of that. So why are you mad that you didn't get ice cream tonight? I mean, I still love you. You still in the house. I didn't kick you out the house. I didn't pack a bag, but you're not going to get the blessing like that. And so many of us, holiness and striving and effort, have all been put over into the legalism camp. And as a result, our general Christianity is just loose. And so we've kind of gone from the extreme of legalism all the way over to the extreme of antinomianism. And it shows, because when the commands come, we act like obedience is not an option, at least within the broader culture. So we're fathers of the house, and the blessings are manifold. You're not a fatherless child. You have a father. You have a family. You have a home. You have an important history and a spiritual lineage, because all the brothers and sisters that came before you are in your family. You have brothers and sisters in the faith. You have aunts and uncles in the faith. You have grandmothers and grandfathers in the faith. My point here, humbly, let us not act out as if we don't know our name. As if we don't have a daddy to teach us. Know who you are, beloved, and live accordingly. There are great blessings, but there are great responsibilities. And the writer of Hebrews is not ashamed to deal with this at all. Matter of fact, the very next word takes us there. If. Verse 6, we see this in Hebrews. It messes with us a little bit, and it's good. We need it. But Christ has his son over his own house, whose house we are, if. If. No one likes that word in this context. But here it is. And I was joking around. I sent this to, I think to Harry, sent this to this week as I was writing this. I said, whomever the author of Hebrews was, he was not a proponent of easy believism. And if you're familiar with that doctrine at all, I'll put a couple links down there if you're not familiar with it, though. But that's the old, say a prayer, spin around, don't worry about how you live. Right? You're saved and go live like the devil and it's all good. And I'm saying, no, if you're actually saved, you're going to want to live a certain way. You may struggle, but I'm not saying you're saved by works. I'm saying the saved work. It's just who we are. How do you taste the goodness of Jesus Christ and then live like the devil on purpose forever? Impossible. The salvation of the Lord is too great. Amen. And Hebrews makes that point over and over again. If here is a conjunction that links faith to obedience. It's a culturally, I call it, uneasy qualifier because it calls us beyond confession to actual consecration. It's saying, as we talked about in Titus last week, that grace trains us unto righteousness. It's not anti-grace, but if you receive grace, there's a certain way that you're going to go about things because you're so overwhelmed by the grace. And this is common in Hebrews. I mean, we'll cover a few of these as we go along, but remember this from Hebrews 2:1, sir.
Therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let
them
slip.
There's always this warning about backing up in Hebrews. Look at chapter 4, verse 1.
Let us therefore fear, lest that a promise being left us and entering into his rest of any of you should seem to come short of. Yep.
All these are warnings throughout Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 26.
For if we sin willfully after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sins, but a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation, which shall devour the adversaries.
I mean, the writer of Hebrews was not saying do whatever you want in Jesus' name. But Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15, sir.
Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled.
And many be defiled. Bitterness is a terrible, terrible thing. More on that when we get to chapter 12, Lord willing. But look at that same chapter, verse 25, sir.
See that ye refuse not him that speaketh, for if they escape not who refuse him that spake on earth, how much more shall ye not, we escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven?
Now, to be clear, we don't believe that, you know, that you lose your salvation. We just believe that the saved work. The saved act saved. And the saved repent often because we know that we miss it a lot. There ought to be something different about a spirit-filled person. That's what I'm trying to say. Talk to me, somebody. How does the Spirit of God live in you and you live exactly the same? So this if here is a little uncomfortable. Because no, you know, I don't have to do anything to earn God's love. I didn't say that. I said the fact that you receive God's love means you want to please him. You want to please the one who said, if you love me, keep my commandments. You want to please him. And so that life, so you're so overwhelmed by the love of God, the grace of God, the mercy of God, that you go, okay, Lord, what do you want me to do? Obedience is your option. Obedience is actually God's love language. There's one person that got that. Praise God. You know what? For you parents, it's yours too. As much as you like the, you know, your sons and daughters saying nice things to you, when they're walking like you teach them, that's when you're like, wow, look at that. Yes. Yes. Okay? And so this if here, we are members of God's household. This is huge, huge blessings that come with that, but also huge responsibilities that come with that. Now, look out in the land. Y'all okay? Look out in the land. Do you see the impact of God's household? Now, it is there, but overtly, do you see the holy people, the holy brethren? Where are they? Where are we? We look, talk, sound, act pretty much like everybody else. Raise our kids the same, go to the same, spend the same, debt the same, everything the same. I'm just saying, maybe we ought to rethink that and kind of obey our way into sanctification here so that our lives match our status as members of God's house. And then when we fail, because we will a lot, we go, Lord, I blew that one big time. Or we harm our brother and sister with our word. Oh, please forgive me. I shouldn't let that thing come out my mouth. But we are members of God's household. And like James, the Lord's brother, true faith to the writer of Hebrews had to be proved by perseverance in works. James 2:19, sir.
Thou believest that there is one God. Thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. But what thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is
dead. Wait a minute. I believe in God, so does the devil. I didn't want y'all to miss that. I believe, so does the devil. So those words, I believe, put together, sound nice, but they need to be backed up by something. There's a proving of the Holy Spirit in you. You will be different. The devil believes too. But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac and his son upon the altar? Justification, of course, here meaning that his faith was proven. Seest thou how faith wrought with his works? And by works was faith made perfect. That's in your Bible. It's in my Bible. And so we know that God saves us by his grace. We can add nothing to our salvation. We know that it was his work and not our work. But when he transforms us and puts us in his household, we're expected to keep the house rules. And so that if it's there for those who want to be in the house but don't want to obey the house. And I'm talking about God's house now. I'm talking about God's house. So the point here, true members of God's household, they're going to hold on. They're going to keep on going. That if, they're going to wrestle with the tension of that if, and they're going to make their calling and election sure, and they're going to self-examine. And by the way, the other way has gotten us in an awful pickle out there. This is how you get gay-affirming Christians. This is how you get LGBTQ plus Christians. This is how we celebrate immodesty and promiscuity and adultery and fornication. This is how we're okay with lying. We're not repenting about any of that. I mean, in general, you know, there's a swath of the Christian culture that's not repenting of any of those things. They're looking at us like, why aren't you loving us? Well, we are. Repent. Just like I would, if I'm in sin, you tell me to repent. That's how you love me. So we got to hold fast. Somebody say hold fast. Hold fast. Not by our own power, not by our own strength, but we hold fast to our faith, our confidence in Christ. And this is the focus of this particular if. True members of God's household prove themselves by their perseverance. Of course, we can only persevere by God's power. No one mishear me. And only by the strength of the Holy Spirit. No one mishear me. But our lives, however mistake prone, will show faith. This is in accordance with all the many commands to go and do exactly that. They're ubiquitous throughout Scripture. In addition to some other titles like salt and light and army and all of that. I mean, it's all in there. And there's a reason for this. There's a reason why we have to be the called out ones. There's not in arrogance, not in holier than thou, but in an honest attempt to obey our Lord. We are members of the household. And this is my prayer, y'all. When folk visit us, I want them to see God's household in action. I want them to see God's household. I don't want to see my household. I don't want them to see some carnal household. I want them to be transported. When they walk through those doors, I want them to be transported from the secular into the holy. Just immersed in what is this? Now, many people say, no, that's a wrong strategy because you can't win them like that. Well, wait a minute. What you win them with is what you win them to. And so if we can't win them with just straight preaching the word, right? If we can't win them with singing songs that honor God, if we can't win them with a church that's trying to grow in love and holiness, but if I got to do clown tricks to win you, you're not ready for me yet. You're not ready for this yet. The Holy Spirit of God is the only one that can make your affections change to long for those things. So if I got to turn into a clown to win you, then I got to keep clowning to keep you. But if you hear the word exegeted and the word is coming, you know I love you. But here it is. I love you. Hold on. I love you. But boom. Need that. Need it. Need my world shook by the word of God. Need to be uncomfortable sometimes. Need to sit there sometimes and go, he talking to me. Lord, he talking to me. Need it. And so if the ordinary means of grace aren't enough, then we keep praying and we keep trusting God till they are. That means the Lord's working with you. But that's why we're not doing that other stuff. We're not going to do it next week either. We're going to come in and preach the word and say, everybody, I love you. Here's the gospel of Jesus Christ. Go repent, turn from sin, be saved from this perverse and wicked generation. I can't do better than the Bible. And neither can you, by the way. Neither can you, okay? And so we're supposed to hold on. We're supposed to persevere. Y'all okay? Can I have 10 more minutes? We're supposed to persevere. Read Hebrews 4:14, sir.
Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession.
Somebody shout, hold fast. That's in your Bible. Now, is it by your power? No, it's by his, but we're still holding. There's still a responsibility there to seek God so that we hold fast our profession. Hebrews 10 says it this way, sir.
Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering.
Without wavering. That's what he's asking us to do. That's what he's commanding us to do, even though we sometimes fail. For he is faithful that promised. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and good works. What, sir?
Not forsaking.
Not forsaking. This is not what we do. Keep reading, sir.
The assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is.
But what?
Exhorting one another in so much that the more as ye see the day approaching.
That's right. That's right. We hold fast to our profession. We don't forsake the assembly. We don't forsake the things of God. And when we do, prayerfully, somebody will call us out on it so we can get back in line and get back in the house where we belong. The ark of safety, if you will. Not that you lost your salvation, but sometimes you on punishment. I'm on punishment for the stuff that I say and do. Beloved, we have come to believe that this idea of learning to hold on, to persevere, to prove, to be tested and prove, is one of God's motivations for allowing trials in our lives. It's not his only motivation. We can't know the mind of God, but there's too many verses that declare this. Sometimes God allows what you're going through, allows you to receive an uncomfortable this or that, read an uncomfortable verse, be checked, be challenged, to see if you can, to develop your holding on skills. Anything worth doing requires perseverance on the long haul. And there's some things that you're going through right now that it may not be the devil. It might be God telling you, showing you how to hold on even when you don't feel like holding on. Amen. How to trust him, even in the midst of it. This is what members of God's household do. Look at James 1, sir, read.
My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience.
Patience is what we need.
But let patience have a perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing.
God wants us to have patience. Sometimes your faith is tried just for that purpose. Why is this happening? So you will learn to wait. So I'll learn to wait. And that might be the only reason. James 1 from the New Living says, dear brothers and sisters, when troubles of any kind come your way, consider an opportunity for great joy, for you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. That's a good point. Some of what you're going through is a whole fast test. What grade are you getting? Somebody needed that one this morning, and praise God for it. So we're holding fast, but we're also rejoicing in hope. I love the word rejoicing here. Most versions don't have it, but King James says rejoicing in hope. It's a word in Greek that means to boast. It could also mean to glory in or rejoice. Most versions translated confidence. Our confidence or boasting isn't, and that's okay. That's okay. Our confidence or boasting isn't prideful or based in human strength. It is based in what God has done. So this is a happy, this is a joyful confidence. In other words, we know that God's got it. We don't always understand what it is, but we know that God's got it. Therefore, we can rejoice in hope. Hope is something. Hope is like faith, where we're looking out, waiting for something to happen. But we're also confident. We're also rejoicing. Therefore, the persevering saint lives a life filled with faith, accompanied by rejoicing. Why? They have hope. And hope is a very precious thing. But their hope is not in worldly change. It's in Christ. Can Christ change anything? Somebody shout yes. But if he doesn't, can you still rejoice? Yes. They confidently celebrate and count it all joy regardless of what comes. Paul from prison gives us the right, confident, and joyful attitude. Here's the apostle, one of the prison epistles, the book of Philippians, you know, locked up and exhorting everybody else to rejoice. Read, sir.
What then? Notwithstanding, every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached, and I therein do rejoice, yea, and will rejoice.
And will rejoice.
For I know that this shall turn to my salvation through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, according to my earnest expectation and my hope that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but that with all boldness, as always, so now also Christ shall be magnified
in my body, whether it be by what?
Life or death.
Or death. For what?
Me to live is Christ, and to die is gain.
If you ever get that, I get this, I can understand this for short bursts. I can understand this for like 2 hours a month or something, you know, before the world over. But when I get it, I am at my most joyful. For to me to live is Christ, I'm a member of his household. I mean, what? It can't get any better than this. And to die is gain. That means if I die, it gets better. It gets better. And so that's when the Christian's hands go up and they get to doing God's business with a smile on their face. For to me to live is Christ. Woo! Let's do this thing. And to die is gain. Woo! Most of us simply don't live this way. We simply don't live this way. We don't live like this is a part of the inheritance of the children of God, that we're members of a household, that we've been kept by the power of God. He says in Philippians 2:14, do all things without murmuring and disputing, that ye may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom ye shine as lights in the world, holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ and have not run in vain, neither labored in vain. Yea, and if I be offered upon the sacrifice and service of your faith, I joy and rejoice with you all. For the same cause also do ye joy and rejoice with me. Paul's saying, man, even if I die for y'all, I'm rejoicing. I want y'all to rejoice too. That's the attitude that members of the household have when we understand that we can rejoice in hope. We can be confident in the hope that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh and is coming back again. And then because of that, we stand firm unto the end. We stand firm unto the end. We might waver, we might have moments, but I'm not going back. Jesus is holding me. I'm going all the way with the Lord. I mean, so if the world shifts and persecution comes to American Christians like African Christians or like Chinese Christians or like Christians, I mean, all the way to the end. If we got to put stuff up, you know, and realize that it's you know, too much of our happiness is tied to our portfolio and our house and our car. And you really want to know who we are, let that thing get shaken. We found out a lot about who we were when COVID happened. And we don't like what most of us don't even want to admit the stuff we found out about ourselves. Fear absolutely overtook us. And we said and did things that we're ashamed of now. We did, as a culture, all right? Hopefully not many Christians did some of that stuff. But firm to the end, we're holding on. Members of God's household, we are protected and held secure by Christ. We can stand firm unto the end because of Christ. John 10, sir.
My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give unto them the eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of
my
hand.
I'm so glad about that. My Father, which gave them me, is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. My Father and I are one. I'm glad I'm being kept, not by my own power, but by God's. And so even with the truth that I'm being called to press and hold fast and persevere, it's God's power ultimately. And so what did the great church father say? You know, pray like it's up to God and work like it's up to you. And that's pretty accurate here. I got to give God my all. He commands that. He's worthy of that. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. At the same time, I'm being kept by God because my own strength eventually would fail me. 1 Peter 1. One of my favorite verses again, verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again into a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead to an inheritance, what?
Incorruptible
and undefiled and fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God. Come on, can you lift one hand right there and say, thank you, Jesus.
Jesus.
Yeah, I mean, I'm encouraging you to persevere. I'm also letting you know you're being kept by God's power. You're being kept by God's power. When your hands go down and you're done, it's God who has you. You're a member of his household, and no man can pluck you or snatch you out of his hand. And so, there are two things going on here. This call to live a certain way, but also the acknowledgement that it's God who's the one who's empowering the living. And the writer of Hebrews is not ashamed of that at all. And then, you know, here's a verse you hear all the time from Jude. Our standard benediction, now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. He keeps you from falling. He's keeping us. The connotation in our verse is that the believer must desire to be steadfast and endeavor to do so. The transformed saint will hunger after righteousness and attempt to be faithful, to hold fast to God's and his word, and to strive to obey. Scripture, again, replete with similar commands. 1 Corinthians 15:58. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye what? Steadfast, unmovable. We're supposed to always be what? Abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Hebrews 3:14 again, for ye are made partakers of Christ if, another if down there, we'll get to it, we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end. It's causing us to check ourselves. Are we really in the faith? I'm doing all these things that are contrary to God. Is my calling and election sure? Because that if messes with us a little bit. And then 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 25, sir.
And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown. But we...
Oh, I love that. Incorruptible crown.
And I therefore so run, not as uncertainty. For so to fight, I, not as the one that beateth the air, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be
captured. Now, obviously, Paul was relying on the power of the Holy Spirit, but he says here, I keep my body and bring it into subjection, lest by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be cast away. And so one of the corrections that Hebrews brings to us in our very grace-saturated culture is that somehow grace means a lack of effort on the part of the Christian. Our effort doesn't save us, never has, never will. We're not saved by works. However, a transformed heart is going to want to give God its all. A transformed heart is going to be broken by its sin. A transformed heart is going to look at things that don't please the master and go, oh, Lord, what is this? Please help me. A transformed heart is going to say, Lord, I'm a member of your household. You set the house rules. Help me to walk by them. Right? So no easy believism in Hebrews at all, in the Bible at all. And it's a nice check for us to think that we can be saved and live any kind of way with no prick of conscience and no desire to honor God and no desire. It's a nice little warning for those who maybe, oh, okay, I said a prayer in 2010 at church. You've been back to church since? No. You read your Bible since? No. Prayed? No. Fast? No. Go to church? No. No. But I'm a Christian. And we would look at that person and go, okay, I don't know your heart, but you should probably get back on your knees and figure this out. Because the salvation of the Lord is too great. The transforming power of Jesus Christ is too great. Even those of us who mess up a lot, and that's all of us, when we mess up, it messes with us. Talk to me. When we sin, anybody ever been just like looking at yourself like with disgust, like, what was that? That's good. Because if you went and did what you do, and then we're like, whoop, that was good. God is good with it. Something's wrong. Something's wrong. Something's wrong. There ought to be a conviction by the Holy Spirit when we fail. And that ought to drive us then to our knees. We are members of the household if. And that check right there is often needed in our lives. And so here's the point. All of these things are by the power of God, by the Holy Spirit, and flows from God's grace. But as our Lord sanctifies us, guess what he does? He changes our desires. If you've been walking with the Lord for a year, 2, 3, 5, 10, you ought to see some changing of your proclivities, of your affections. Your sin nature still wants to do, but your affections have shifting. What are you longing for shifts? Even if when I'm sinning and messing up, I'm longing for something different than that. I said that, but I long to say it better. And if that's not present, something's wrong. Something's wrong. You're a member of the house. Jesus is building. He owns the house. He's the foundation of the house. You're in the house. How is it that you don't act like house people? If that's you, may not be you. He changes us. Have your desires to be faithful increased? Not just come to church and check the box, but have your desires to be faithful increased. Beloved, we're living in a very serious day. It's a season where things are being made clear in so many different ways. And you're, as much as you may not want to, you're not going to be able to avoid picking a side in some areas. Can I just encourage you to go to your Bible, figure out what the Lord has said, and choose the Lord's side, and then let the chips kind of fall where they may. Even if you try to control the chips falling, you couldn't. Well, here's what you can control by his grace. holding to what God said, being faithful, persevering, repenting quickly when you blow it, and getting back up and saying, okay, I'm a member of the house. I don't want to bring shame to my Lord or his house. If. And then rejoice in the confident hope of the coming of our Lord. If you died faithful, that's a good death. Thank you, Lord, for keeping us unto faithfulness and helping us unto holiness. May we, as members of God's household, when our faith is tried, and it will be, come forth, as Job said, as pure gold. Amen, amen, amen. So to be really, really clear, we're not teaching salvation by works. We believe that we're saved by grace through faith in Christ alone. We're simply saying that Christians are called to live a certain way, and we should go about God's business humbly, meekly, but passionately. And the world needs to see it. Quite frankly, the world needs to see it. If you're visiting with us today, thank you for coming. We're glad that you're with us. If you'd like to know more or become a part of our church, you can go to our website, calvaryreformationchurch.org, click become a member. We're about to introduce some new members here before you right now, right after we do our offering in the Lord's table. But if you've seen enough and you're like, yes, let's go to work together, we're happy to have you. Don't forget next Sunday, a lot going on. Invite your whole block. We'll figure it out. we'll figure it out, but we'll be preaching as hard as we can, with as much love as we can next week, Lord willing. Let's now pray over our offering and get prepared for the Lord's table, and then the pastors and ministers are going to help me with bringing in our new members. Brother Benjamin and Brother Twan and Brother Jesha in just a moment. And Twan, when you come up, Jasmine and the baby, welcome whenever you come up. All right. Let's pray over our offering. Y'all ready to give? You know, if we don't talk a lot about, you know, a whole lot with giving. We just exhort you to do it, and y'all have been so faithful. But it is a part of our worship. It is part of our worship time, and we just want to continue to exhort you to be faithful. You know, pray about it and make sure that your household is doing its best as it gives back to the God who gave you everything. Let's pray. Father, thank you for faithful saints. Lord, thank you for the if and the rejoicing and hope and the call to being steadfast, reminding that we're members of your household, that there are some requirements as well as some great privileges of being members of the house. We're so glad that you chose us. We didn't choose you. You chose us, and we're grateful, very grateful. Lord, I ask you to continue to help us stay employed and to be able to not just give, Lord, in the church, but to give outside the church, to store up something for our children's children as well, to handle our resources in ways that give you praise. Thank you, Lord, in advance for all you're doing in this area, in Jesus' name, amen. You can give in the back as you're on your way out. Many of you are giving on the app, and that's great. Thank you so much. The Lord's table, if you're a Christian, please get your communion, your Lord's table elements. If you're not a believer, hold on, hold fast. Just kind of watch, because this is an ordinance that's for believers. Ordinances are for believers. Just kind of observe, and it's okay. Are we ready? Okay, we'll start with the wafer. By the way, we do this weekly. We just think it fits the pattern in the New Testament quite well. For I've received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he brake it, he said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. This is a symbol, a representation of the body of Jesus Christ that was mutilated, tortured, nails and thorns and humiliation for our sin. Please take it, and in remembrance of him, please break it and eat all of it. Glory to God. Glory to God. After the same manner also, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. This is a symbol of the blood of Jesus Christ. The Bible says that there's no remission of sin without the shedding of blood, that the life of a thing is in the blood. And God is so serious brings such a visceral distaste in the heart of God concerning sin that the blood of his son had to be poured out to cause it to be remitted or to be washed away. And this is what this reminds us of. So take the cup, and in remembrance of the blood of Christ being poured out for our sin, please drink all of it. Thank you, Master, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. Come on, can we give the Lord a hand clap right quick? Oh, come on, y'all. Y'all do better than that.
Just two?
Okay. All right, so we want to bring up Twan and the Travers family. Can you come up, sir, wherever you be? Amen. Come on, give them Jasmine a hand. And Benjamin. All right, and our good friend Ben Phillips. Come on, Ben, where are you, bro? Right there. All right. Come on up, brother. Come on up. Come on up. We got to get Jesse out another time, I guess. Yes. All right. All right. So for those of you who are unaware, we take church membership like really seriously, not like culty serious, but we really do believe that it's important that people are part of a local assembly. I know that's not the most popular message these days. And now when people come, they join of their own volition. They leave of their own volition. So it's nothing like that. But when you're here, we do view it more like a covenant. We really do. We really look at it like, okay, you know, in order for you to really grow, there are going to be moments where you have some tough times. And the idea of a covenant causes you hopefully to stick in there a little bit and grow when it gets a little tough. And that's the way it is in life. I mean, you know, that's the way it is in life. So all of our members get this nice plaque. Now, we didn't always do this. When you first joined, you got 8.5 by 11 piece of paper. But now we do this nice little plaque. It has our church covenant on it. And it says in part, I'm not going to read all of it, but it says in part, I covenant to serve Christ to the best of my ability, carrying my personal cross and keeping him in focus as best I can on a daily basis. I covenant to be faithful to my church. I will not tear it down with my words. Rather, I will lift it up with my actions. I covenant to submit to the church leadership as scripture teaches and to pray for and support the vision of the church. I covenant to be a faithful giver, striving always towards the 10% model. That's what we believe here, a model, not a mandate. With cheerful and passionate heart, giving in faith, and giving out of my love for Christ, I covenant to conduct myself within biblical standards of holiness. I will dress in a manner befitting a Christian, avoiding tempting inappropriate situations, rid my life of vices, and otherwise strive to represent Christ with honor every day of my life. I covenant to set the example in Sunday worship and care group attendance, and will do so with punctuality. That means we show up. One day the Lord's going to heal me right there and set me free. It's the old military man in me. I can't shake it. On time, right? I covenant to spend considerable time practicing the spiritual disciplines, prayer, meditation of the word and study of the word, personal holiness, fasting when necessary. I covenant to, when conflicts arise, immediately seek out only those involved. I will not hold grudges and will quickly forgive any wrongdoing. I will pass negatives up and positives down. We don't gossip. We hate gossip. I covenant to share my faith consistently and passionately as Christ gives me opportunity. And I covenant as needed to disciple my family, or as I have opportunity, because if you're not married, but to disciple my family and children, to strive for multi-generational faithfulness within my own home. I will ensure consistent times of family devotions and worship are a part of my daily living. And so it says Christian commitment to discipleship has our vision triangle on it. And this one is for the Travers family. Yes. Young man, proud of you. What's up, boy? His beautiful wife here. Had the honor to marry them too. And this one here is for my friend Benjamin. Well done, sir. Well done. Come on, pastors, help me. Amen. Church, would y'all help us pray as we pray over these new folks? And then after that, we'll bless the food and say our benediction, and y'all come and greet them. Amen. Amen. Father, thank you for Ben. Thank you for his family, Lord. Thank you for his journey in you up until this point. Thank you, Lord, that he is learning. He leaps and bounds. Thank you for Pastor Prophet and his discipling efforts. Lord, thank you for all that Ben is good at and is growing in, his passion for the word, his love for the church, his love for his family. And we pray that his time with us would be so very fruitful. Lord, from the crown of his head to the very soles of his feet, we just ask your blessing, your anointing, that you fill him with your spirit, keep him thirsty for your word, thirsty for your throne, and that just as he is learning from us, Lord, we would also learn from him and be recipients of the gifts and the talents and the skills that you have given him and are growing in him. We now put him and set him into this local assembly with all of the rights and privileges and responsibilities thereof as a member of Calvary Reformation Church. In Jesus' name, amen. And Lord, we thank you for Tuan. We thank you for Jasmine. We thank you for this entire family, the whole kind of Freeman patriarchy household here. We're so grateful, Lord, for that man of God who's poured so much into this young man, and it's so evident. And we're so grateful, Lord, for Tuan, and his growth in you is just amazing. Lord, what you're doing in him is his thirst for the word, his thirst for worship, how he's loving on his wife, and how he wants to raise his son up in the fear and admonition of the Lord. Father, we thank you for what you're doing in him. Heal him from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet. Lord, as we set him into the house, O Lord, with all the rights and responsibilities thereof as a member of Calvary Reformation Church, let everything that he does, everything that he touches, give your name glory and honor. And as he learns from us, Lord, we are thankful to be able to learn from him as well. Thank you for him, Lord. We are enriched by him and Ben as well. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Thank you, sir. One more prayer. We'll pray over the food. There's going to be some food back there from, what's the name of that place again? Scrimp Shack. Next week, Resurrection Sunday, all week long, a video coming to you. Please stay locked in, learn from it, enjoy it. And then, like I said, invite the whole block. You might be surprised who will come to church on Resurrection Sunday so we can hear the word of God. And hopefully God will do some amazing things as a result of it all. Come on, let's pray together. Lord, thank you for those visiting with us today. Thank you for these new members that have come into the house. We are so grateful for them to have the privilege, these young men who are coming into the kingdom of God and into the church of the living God, which is the pillar and ground of truth. We pray, O Lord, for them and all their endeavors. And we pray that as we celebrate them and celebrate you today on this beautiful Palm Sunday, that you would bless our food and our fellowship, that we wouldn't run out, but we would look for 5 to 10 people to just bless, encourage, say something kind to. We all need it. We all need encouragement as members of your household. We love you and thank you for all you've done. In Jesus' name we pray. Am I missing anything? Did I miss anything? Okay, come on, let's stand together, and then we'll be dismissed. And then when we say amen, Dory's going to play Reformation Hymn, but we'll close out a little different as y'all are humming it, singing it. I want you to, I did bless the food, didn't I? I did. Did I bless the food? I did that. I blessed the shrimp. I blessed the shrimp. Dory's going to play, and then you guys can come and greet these new members. Let's lift up our hands. Thank you, Lord, for your mercy. You didn't have to let us see another Sunday, but you did. Lord, if I messed up in any way, please forgive me. Let your people only remember and hear those things that come from you. We pray in Jesus' name that you would continue to bless and strengthen us this week. Let it be a week of evangelism, a week of prayer, a week of considering the goodness of God in Christ Jesus. Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling, to present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. All of the members of God's household said amen. 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 Come on and greet these guys. See you out front.